things off. My name for those I haven't had a chance to meet yet, virtually or in person, is Jim McLaughlin. I'm the Assistant Vice President for Community Development, Outreach, and Partnerships for the IC3 Movement, and I'm based here in Philadelphia. I'm so happy to see everyone here. Welcome. We're just inviting everyone to share where they're coming from, your school, your organization, your institution, in the chat. We'd love to see that, where you're coming from, and also city and country. I have with me here, in addition to, of course, lots of our friends and colleagues from around the world, a dear friend and IC3 leader, Veer Singh Anand, from the University of St. Andrews, who, of course, is the chair of the 2023 annual IC3 conference. Veer, just a quick word from you.
Thank you, Jim. Just excitement. You know, it feels surreal to be here and really talking about the 2023 annual IC3 conference and expo, and lovely to see everyone come together. So thank you for organizing this.
Yeah, it's great. Okay, so I'm going to just share my screen, everyone. I think let's go ahead and kick it off. We're happy to take questions throughout, and you can put those questions in the chat. You know, and I'll share that I am I and Veer are stepping in for Ganesh today, and but please share that you know, your questions in the chat as we go. We're happy to answer all of those. I'm sure there are many, but as we kick off, I know that many of us, how many of us have had the chance to attend a regional forum so far this year? Just by a show of hands, you can put that in the chat. You can just go ahead and share. You can raise your hand. I hope you're enjoying the regionals as well. A number of regional forums have already happened. First time forums in many different parts of the world that are going on. And I hope you're really enjoying that. You know, the regional forums, as I know we're here to talk about the conference, but really thinking about the context of access and inclusion, which is a core principle for IC3. The regional forums really allow us to have these conversations, important conversations around counseling in specific regions around the world. So do look at the regional forums. If you've not registered for those, please go ahead and do that. We'd love to welcome and see you there. So now, as we turn attention to the 2023 annual IC3 conference and expo, I think by now, many of you and most of you are probably aware that we are going back to the beautiful city of Hyderabad for the second year in a row. This is not an accident. And how many of us were there in 2022 at the conference? Yeah, and for those of us that were there at the conference, I'd love for you just to share one word that comes to mind in the chat about that experience. You know, what was it like to be at the 2022 annual IC3 conference in Hyderabad? You can share that in the chat. But, you know, going back to Hyderabad is actually very significant. This is the first time ever that the IC3 conference has been in the same city for 2 years in a row. For all of us that were there, we know that the host school family, all of our friends, the entire city, just the very rich culture that is in Hyderabad, and not to mention the venue at the HICC, was really just incredible. So the decision was made to go back to Hyderabad, and really, you know, the scale at which this conference is reaching is, you know, is sometimes really just beyond my imagination. You know, as we see, for many of us who were there at the very first IC3 conference back in 2016, there were about 285 of us who were present at that time. Last year in Hyderabad, there were more than 1,400 colleagues. So we'll talk a little bit about what's changing for 2023, all of the different elements that you'll see and what you can expect, and actually how you can help really create the magic around the conference, how you can contribute, how you can share your knowledge, and how you can help to create access for schools around the world. to really participate in and be transformed at what is now the largest career in college counseling conference anywhere outside of the United States, which is IC3. For many of us that were there last year, you know, there was a, of course, the theme of access was there formally, but, you know, part of what we took on was this theme of music, flowers, love, and logistics. You might remember those four words as we were there in Hyderabad: music, flowers, love, and logistics. And I think now, as we think of 2023, what is the magic that we can bring together? What is the magic that we can create coming back to Hyderabad for the second time in a row? And it is important for us to remember that IC3 will continue to be a hybrid conference. This is also very intentional. Now, I think the COVID period sort of forced us into a hybrid mode, all of us. But now what we've seen is that there's such beauty in this opportunity to connect. And wherever you are around the world, of course, we hope you'll have the chance to be there with us in person. There's nothing like that experience of being there together physically. But that said, we live in a very hybrid world now. So this is a hybrid conference, whether you're there in person or whether you're there virtually, fully integrated within the sessions, fully integrated within those large events, fully integrated with networking on the platform and all of that. Just remembering that this is actually a hybrid conference still, and creating that access is something that is so important for IC3. So one of the huge and, you know, I think very significant elements that we can expect in 2023 is a doubling. There is a multiplying effect that we're seeing. And for, as I'd shared, there were more than 1,400 colleagues who'd participated in the hybrid conference last year. And I think many of us who were there in person, and whether you were there in person or virtual, you know, you could see that ballroom, right? How massive that ballroom was, what the energy was like when we were there for the opening keynote, and just being in that space together. Now imagine that was actually only half of the venue at the HICC. That was only half of that venue. So one of the biggest differences from 2022 to 2023 is actually the scale of the conference. IC3 has now reserved the entire venue, right? So that ballroom that you're thinking about will actually double in size. It will be prepared to seat 3,000 people. Can you imagine? And now also you can picture the IC3 Expo as well, right? That IC3 Expo where, you know, the pavilions were, the IC3 Pavilion, the Study in Scotland Pavilion, all of those, the places where lunch and the meals were served, and just that great networking and interaction that was happening there in the Expo, that space will also double, right? So that's one thing that I really want us to take in, is that we're doubling down in terms of the space, in terms of the venue, in terms of the need, in terms of the access that will be created around this conference. That's really, really important. And what I want to point out here, of course, in addition to the scale, is that it's very important that we come together and connect. The learning we know, and we'll talk about the content, we'll talk about all of the learning and knowledge sharing, not just how you can benefit, but how you can also contribute. I want to share that really what's critical about the conference is that we are coming together, and that the host school committees, the leadership team within IC3 recognize how important it is for us to come together. So what will be reflected in the schedule is really much more time for us to come together, to connect. We'll get into some of those details here today. But also around the special events, you know, you will see some new events that will come as well. A pre-conference dinner series. All right, so look out for opportunities the night before the main conference begins, where you can actually, if you're a school delegate and a university delegate, come and interact, learn already. All right, we'll talk about some workshops and all of these pieces. That's really critical as well. There will be a benefit concert for the IC3 Institute at the conclusion of the conference. We'll give a little bit more information about that as well, but I'm just highlighting some of those here. in terms of what we'll be discussing today. And I would also invite, please be sure that, you know, as you come in, you have questions, you can put them in the chat. We will have a formal Q&A round at the conclusion of the webinar, but please feel free to put in those questions in the chat now. Veer, over to you.
Thank you, Jim. And I think it's great that you've built this excitement. It's always lovely to talk to Jim because, you know, I find someone who shares the same amount of excitement about the conferences I do. So thank you for that, Jim. But I really want to talk about the conference in from a standpoint of professional development. And I think the conference has two ways of spreading knowledge. You know, you've got the sessions, and I'll come to that in a bit. But I think there's so much knowledge and learning that's actually shared in the corridors of the conference. When you meet people, you interact with people in the networking sessions. I think it's the conversations themselves are so enriching, and from a personal standpoint over the years, they've been a great platform to grow and learn as well. But we talk about, maybe we underappreciate really the caliber of the sessions that that we put together in the conference. There's some sessions that are really enlightening. They have the content is curated, and a lot of work is really put into the content at the conference, and it really provides a solid foundation and base for the conference. So for those who remember the conference from last year, access was the theme. This year we've got another theme to really delve into, and that is finding purpose through counseling. And I think it's really fitting to have that as a theme. So when we talk about finding purpose through counseling, when I think about this theme, you know, is it just creating a room in a building and putting, you know, a few chairs and a table there? Is that counseling? It really isn't. It's about transforming society, allowing students and young adults to really explore what their purpose in their life is, to helping them find that purpose, to inspire them to reach that potential and to follow that purpose that they have in life. And to do that, we've got six different sub-themes. And there's a very elaborate document that you can look at on the website, and if colleagues can just put a link to that. But, you know, for the first sub-theme, and something that I think a lot of us would resonate with, is ethics in counseling. You know, to be unbiased, to allow for that relationship with parents and students to really grow from a very unbiased standpoint. I think it's a very, very important sub-theme to explore. We've got context through counseling. So talking about careers, career-related outcomes, but bridging that gap between careers and post-secondary education, we want to think about humanities and the social sciences and where does that lead to in terms of careers, and really delving into some of those aspects as well. The third sub-theme we've got this year is counseling as a shared responsibility. Is it only the counselor's responsibility to allow students to take those important decisions in their careers? I really don't think so. It needs to be even universities. Colleagues and people like myself who work for universities need to have a counseling-based approach as well. We need every teacher really to be a 10% counselor, you know, and that's something that we can really look at to allow students to find this purpose in their lives. Fourth, access. And access was a theme last year, but I think it's always going to be a key role and a key aspect of the DIC3 movement and the conference. And so really to delve into that subtopic, sub-theme a little bit more, but really talking about creating access for students who maybe don't have the same opportunities, to talk about outreach in the right manner, merit-based scholarships. These are some themes that this particular topic addresses. We also want to talk about leadership, you know, how as leaders of schools and universities, are we allowing for this approach and allowing students to find that purpose, you know. So this is another very important sub-theme that has been developed. And lastly, we've got foundations and trends. So are we still thinking about certain aspects of admissions and recruitment from maybe information that dates back to a decade or 5 years back. Landscapes are changing tremendously. We've just gone through the pandemic. What are recent global mobility trends? What's emerging in the next few years? And I think it's really important to have an understanding of that. So, without going into too much more detail in terms of exactly what these sub-themes mean, and we will be sitting with colleagues from the content and research committee in a few weeks from now and really getting into some of these sub-themes and what they might mean. That was just to give you an overview of what the theme is this year and what some of the sub-themes are. So it goes without saying it's going to be two days of a lot of learning, acquiring knowledge, over 45 different sessions. So there will really be something for everyone. If you're a new counselor, there'll be sessions for you. If you have had some experience counseling, there'll be sessions for you as well. And equally for colleagues who work and represent universities, there'll be some real knowledge that'll be shared with you as well. So Jim, I think that's what I would say from a professional development standpoint. I want to make sure
thanks, Veer,
I've not missed anything you may want to add.
I would add that this is not intended to be a passive experience for you. I would urge every one of us to figure out how we can share our knowledge, and you can do that directly. If you have never submitted a session proposal for IC3, if you've never spoken at IC3, if you've never shared your experience at IC3, this could be the year for you to do that. I would encourage you. I think, you know, some of us, we hold back, you know, saying what could I add? And, you know, there's so many more people that have experience in all of this. I think IC3 is really about all of us sharing and being generous with our experience and knowledge, and acknowledging that whether you're a first year professional or you're a 30 year professional, you have something to be shared. Last year in 2022, we did see a record number of session proposals come in. We anticipate that will probably only increase for 2023. And with that, I'm urging every one of us to really say, okay, look at these themes. What really resonates with me? Maybe it's ethics in counseling. Maybe it's counseling as a shared responsibility. How can I collaborate with my colleagues in teaching, in administration, and really make sure that this becomes a critical focus for all of us? So I would urge every one of us here to share ideas that you have and prepare session proposals. And we'll talk about deadlines and all of that as we go. There will be a specific webinar on how to build a dynamic session proposal that will happen on March 1st. Veer will lead that along with Joshua and Vandana, who are chair and co-chair of the Content and Research Committee. So make sure you attend that session. And if we could also share in the chat box, there is an open document where if you're looking for collaborators or you just want to share some ideas and do some brainstorming and connect with people who may have similar ideas around a session proposal, you can please put your name on the session proposal collaboration sheet. And you can also find collaborators there. All right, so let's move on. So in addition, of course, to the professional development and the learning, right, relationship building is a huge part of this. So one of the things that I want to mention first is around the university exhibits and the high school exhibits. These every year are amongst the most popular sessions at the conference. And with what we're expecting this year in the conference to double in size and potentially to see 1,000 schools and 500 universities represented, you can imagine now what this, you know, how important this university exhibits and high school exhibits session is. So this is really an opportunity on the first day of the conference for universities to, you know, every registered university will get a table. And they will have, and high school delegates and organization delegates will then have the chance to circulate around that ballroom and interact one-to-one and have those conversations. And then on day two, the high school exhibits, every registered high school will have their own table. And this is a huge opportunity for those schools to really represent themselves in a global capacity. We're expecting colleagues from 75 plus countries this year. In 2023. So really think about this as an opportunity to represent your institution or your school and to connect with your counterparts on the other side of the desk, so to speak, right? So that you can do that. Really critical. We have expanded the time of those exhibits. Of course, the schedule, there's so much happening at the conference. There's never enough time, But the decision has been made to expand those, all right, to give a little bit more time for people to interact in those exhibits. One significant change this year is around the IC3 Presidential Forum. And for many of us, we already know that that IC3 Presidential Forum is an invite-only event for the senior-most leaders in education. These are senior school principals, they're school directors, their education ministers, their university presidents, chancellors, pro vice chancellors, VPs coming together. In the past, this has happened as a pre-conference event the day before the main conference. But this year, the committee has decided to make the IC3 Presidential Forum actually integrated with the two main days of the conference. So now it will happen on the 23rd and 24th at the venue itself. So this also means that there will likely be 300 or 400 school principals, school leaders from India and around the region and around the world actually present at the venue throughout that conference. For those senior leaders who are on the call today, you want to express interest in attending that, or you're a counselor or you're a university representative and you want to express interest for your school principal, your school director, your university president, a vice president, a dean, to be considered for inclusion at the IC3 Presidential Forum, you can reach out to the team and we'll pass that to the presidential committee that really considers all of those and considers the speakers and all of the invitees as well. You can also indicate that on the registration form, right? So as you're going through the registration process, you can indicate and put contact information in there for senior leaders who you would like to be considered for an invitation at the presidential forum. Now, I want to take a moment to talk about the IC3 Expo, because what you probably have also noticed is that the annual IC3 conference is now the annual IC3 conference and expo. And again, this is very intentional. And what we've learned and what we saw, and I think 2022 just took this interacting outside of the sessions to a new level. We saw a completely different scale. And of course, Veer is here, as chair on behalf of the University of St. Andrews, and the Study in Scotland Consortium of Institutions was really the first ever pavilion at IC3. That will happen again in 2023, except we'll see many more pavilions that are also there, really giving a chance to interact, not just in the sessions and during the plan networking, but also in that expo area. This is really, the scale is expanding significantly. And the mindset for all of us is that, and IC3 is not a place to transact. IC3 is a place to find solutions, to build meaningful relationships. IC3 is not a place to come and buy and sell. That will never be the case for IC3. It's very important for us to really think about what the purpose of why we're coming together is, and really take that purpose into the sessions, take that purpose into the corridors during our networking conversations, take that purpose of counseling in every school into the IC3 Expo. This is really the purpose there. So, you know, we're also going to see a number of school groups and associations that are coming. These are groups of school leaders, groups of institutions that are coming from different parts of the world, coming from different parts of the country and the region, and really coming to Hyderabad specifically for the conference. Veer?
Thank you, Jim. And I think really, really good opportunity to talk about three very exciting initiatives as part of the conference. And the first is the pre-conference workshops. And we do have something new this year, which I would like to elaborate on, is normally we have pre-conference workshops that the IC3 Institute runs for high school delegates. And this happens really at two levels, depending on the experience of the counseling attendees. But we also now have a workshop for university delegates. And I think that's really exciting. It's really delving into multidimensional approaches to outreach and recruitment in South Asia. And it's great learning a day prior to the conference starting. So on the 22nd of August, we have three workshops now, two which will take place for high school delegates and one for university delegates. So something new there to look forward to. We have the IC3 Awards on the 24th of August. And I know there's a lot of excitement always at that days around the awards, and colleagues really look forward to it. But it's celebrating counseling, and it's global and regional awards this year. It's not to create another competition, but it's really to celebrate those who really help students find their purpose and celebrate counseling. So we have the IC3 awards. And lastly, we have something quite exciting. It's a fundraising concert that we're doing. So it's the first time that we're doing this. We're on the 24th of August in the evening. We will have the IC3 Institute benefit concert. And so it is a ticketed event. There will be the opportunity to buy a ticket for this. It's going to be donated and used for the IC3 Institute. So it is a conference. It's really exciting to have that. And that's something new that we're going to include this year as well.
Yeah, Veer, and I'll just add in, and I would love if we could share a link to where the benefit concert and, you know, where tickets can be purchased as well, because there are a couple of things here. The benefit concert, and for those of us that were there, you may remember Anil Srinivasan, who was the opening keynote from last year. You know, one of the most engaging, and, you know, and I still remember that. I actually go back and, you know, watch the recording a number of times already, but, you know, Anil was there with his, piano keyboard on stage, and you might remember that. We're very grateful, to Anil for really, you know, being there, at the benefit concert. This will be hybrid, meaning that it will be possible for those who are, you know, and even, you know, some of my family and friends are coming and, you know, they want to donate to the Institute and enjoy the concert. This is open to all, right? This is open to all. It will actually happen after the IC3 Awards, right? It'll happen after the IC3 Awards. There'll be a little bit of a gap of time for, you know, just preparations and things like that to happen in the venue. But then, of course, physically, the concert will take place there, but it will all be hybrid. So you can purchase a ticket, which all of it will be donated to the Institute, right? So this will be a big effort for supporting counseling, supporting counselor training, and do share, not just within your networks, but also invite your family and friends to attend. Even if they're there virtually, they'll really be supporting an amazing cause, but enjoying some really great music and entertainment on that night as well. Just going backwards before we leave this slide, the IC3 Awards, and Veer had said it, that this is the global and regional awards will now happen. And traditionally, and this is a significant change that I just want to point out, that traditionally at the conference, only the India regional awards were recognized, given the fact that the conference has taken place in India. And then the global and other regional awards have been awarded in December, right, at the annual IC3 Awards, or what was known as the IC3 Festival during, you know, the COVID period. Well, what we'll see now is that there's one awards that will be celebrated at the conference. So all of the regions, all of the global awards will be recognized at the conference itself, not just India. Okay, so that's a significant change. And that was all based on feedback as well in terms of, you know, really bringing the energy around the awards at the same time. So we're excited about that. Okay, Veer, I think we'll, you know, and access is such a huge, huge part of this. Of course, it was the overall theme for 2022. It remains as a sub theme, will remain as a core element of everything we do in IC3. And we want to talk a little bit about how you can get involved in the IC3 scholarship effort to create access for schools.
Yeah, Jim, I think this is brilliant and something I really look forward to every year at the conference, is just meeting the scholars, and there's so much energy that comes from them. And the aim is to have as many scholars as we can at the conference, really. And so for those of you who are first-time attendees, full-time high school counselors, you can apply for the IC3 scholarship at the conference. And this can come in different forms. It might mean, you know, the registration fee that you don't have to pay. It could mean accommodation and in travel in some cases. So there are different categories of scholarships that you can be eligible for. And equally, you know, there is the IC3 engagement grant for NGOs serving in Africa, Latin America, and the Caribbean. So that's another category of scholarships that you may want to look at. And it's important to note, it's not just those seeking the scholarships, but if you know of anyone who can really benefit from the scholarship, it's really important that you go out of your way to nominate them. And we really want to make sure that we can create that access for everyone. And that should not be a barrier. So we're really hoping for more than, 100 scholars this year. I think that's something that we're really passionately working towards. The deadline for scholarship applications is the 30th of June. And so that's something that can be kept in mind as well. So very important aspect, as I said before, access is always going to remain such a key component of the movement and the conference.
Please don't wait until the deadline. If you are thinking of applying for the scholarship, or you're thinking you want to nominate someone, and remember, there may be some IC3 scholars who are actually on this call. And if you were if you've received an IC3 scholarship in the past, what we're the committee really focuses on is eligibility for first-time attendees, for full-time high school employees. If you were an IC3 scholar in the past, I'm sure you'll be nominating some colleagues and sharing across your networks. But what I would encourage is if you are a school counselor, a teacher, a principal, a full-time high school employee who's applying for the scholarship, don't wait until the deadline, right? Because actually the committee can begin reviewing these kind of on a rolling basis. And what we did see last year was that for some of those that applied late, it may have been a little bit more challenging actually to support them. If you're planning on traveling and all of this from outside of India, there can be obviously some travel, visa arrangements that you need to make, travel arrangements that you need to make. So I'm urging everyone to apply early and nominate early. The committee can begin reviewing and placing the resources where we want to see. We want to see at least 100 scholars in person in 2023. This is why we have the conference. And in fact, I would encourage all of our scholars, scholar alumni, and those that may be future scholars to consider not just, what am I going to benefit, but how can I contribute? And that can be in sharing your knowledge in a session proposal. This can be another way that you can do that, but also create access for those in your network that may not be aware that this opportunity exists for them. And I can see it looks like we have a hand raised. So I would say, Saeed, I see your hand. I'm just acknowledging that. We have a couple of more slides and then we'll go to our Q&A. I think that'd be great. All right.
Jim, just
yeah, Veer, please go ahead.
On the scholarships, but just wanted to make sure that we do embrace the truly hybrid version of the conference, and those who are attending virtually may also want to apply for scholarships as well. So it's eligible to in-person attendance as well as those who might want to attend virtually.
That's right. Yeah, this is not specifically for in-person. You can apply for a scholarship regardless of the type. And we want to see a mix. We do want to see a mix. Thanks for pointing that out, Veer. All right, so now as you plan, when you think about the timeline, you can really see those deadlines. And of course, all of this is on the website. And I hope everyone has gone to the site. There's a brand new website that the IC3 movement has just launched. It's completely redesigned. It's a beautiful site. It's very easy to navigate. All of the information, of course, is there. But we wanted you to see this in a snapshot so that you can really plan accordingly. This is the first. Another first for IC3, where there's what's called now a super early bird registration, and we're in that period now. Many have already registered for the conference. We'd encourage you to do that early. The registration, of course, for those that aren't coming under a scholarship, your registration fee. There is a little bit of a break for the super early bird period, and again for the early bird period. But really what this will allow you to do is plan. All of the communication will come out. It allows you really to make the most of the experience leading up to and not just on the days of the conference itself. So it's really important that I think now you're looking at these registration periods and you're taking advantage of that. If you're making a case to your school leader, to your university leader, you're making a proposal to go to the conference, it makes sense to do that now in the super early bird period, given where the sort of registration policies and fees are as it relates to these. So take advantage of that. That will go, the super early bird period will go until March 15th. All right. And then of course, as you can see, April 15th is not only the standard early bird registration deadline, but it is the call for proposals deadline. And that's really what I want to point out here is the call for proposals. And that's a strict deadline. The committee is not able to take to accept submissions after that, given the volume of submissions that come in. So now is the time, put your name on that session collaboration list if you're looking for panelists. But I just want to point out, because we had this question come up a couple of times last year, that session collaboration list that's on, it's basically a shared Excel sheet. The purpose of that is for you to find collaborators. That's not a session proposal itself. Okay, a session proposal, you have to go to the website, and we'll put that link in here as well. You go to the website, and there is a formal session proposal form where you would go through, you list your topic, you list your panelist, your description, your learning objectives, all of those pieces, and you have to submit formally. Make sure you're making those plans by April 15th. And of course, I'm not going to go through and just speak about all of these deadlines, but make sure you're noting them. They're all on the web, whether you're applying for a scholarship, you're proposing a session, you're nominating for the awards, and of course, the conference itself, you want to make sure that you're putting that on your calendar. All right. And then, as we open it up for questions, it's really important for us just to acknowledge all of those who make the conference possible. And you can see Atlas Skill Tech University as the host, University of Arizona as the co-host, Vijayabhumi University as our technology partner. There are many more sponsors that are supporting this. And it's actually these colleagues and these organizations and institutions that are actually supporting access. If you're wondering how an event like this at the scale and the grandness and all of this that can happen at a venue like the HICC, where so many counselors are given scholarships or there's very, very, almost next to nothing in terms of a registration fee, how are we able to do that? Please thank the sponsors when you're interacting with them. Connect with them, learn about them. It's amazing what they're doing, and it's not, this isn't a place to come and, as we said, to transact and do more business and education. These are the institutions and organizations who are actually standing up and saying, we can do this a different way. We can do this in a way that's empowering schools. And it's really critical for us to acknowledge them. So thank you to all of our sponsors. And of course, for those institutions that want to get involved more deeply in partnering, in sponsoring, our partnerships team is here. You can please reach out and learn a little bit more about how you can get involved in that regard. Of course, the IC3 host school family is really the heart around any annual IC3 conference and expo. Whether, the years that it's been in Mumbai and Delhi, of course, this will be the second year in Hyderabad. The host school family is just incredible. And for those of us that experienced the conference last year, we felt that culture through. I mean, how amazing were the student performances? You think about the students coming, you really felt the culture of Hyderabad and just the love that we felt, which is also one of the reasons why we're going back to Hyderabad this year. So Veer, we'll do some next steps and then let's open it up. We have a good period of time for questions. So this is really great timing for us. We'll turn it over to you, Veer, for the next steps and then we'll just open it up.
Yep, thanks, Jim. So I'll keep this brief and quick, but there's really no point talking if we don't take action. So let's really all promise to take some action today post this session. So I think first, let's register, and Jim's really spoke about, registering early and just being part of the process in the lead up to the conference. So 15th March, just as a reminder, is the super early bird deadline. And then we have the deadline for both the early bird registration as well as the session proposal. So 15th April is the deadline for that. I would really encourage everyone to attend the session on the 1st of March. We'll really delve into what makes for a good proposal. And we want new ideas, new speakers, a different perspective. And no one should feel shy of submitting a proposal. Every proposal is really looked at in a lot of detail by the committee. And so we want to make sure that everyone has a solid foundation to submit a proposal that has everything in it to make for a successful proposal. So 15th of April is the deadline for the session proposals. And lastly, to nominate colleagues for the IC3 awards, 15th July is the deadline for that. And let's do that and really encourage everyone to submit nominations for this. You know, I think there's so many of us who work very hard in making sure that we're counseling students in the right way, helping them find purpose and really celebrating counseling as a whole. And let's do that generously as well.
Thanks, Veer. I think this would be a great time to open it up. And, you know, as we think about the next steps, I think you might be asking, why should I register early? What's, you know, why should I not just wait? Obviously, in addition to the sort of, you know, the registration breaks that happen during the super early bird and the early bird period. If you're planning to attend in person, once you register, you will receive invitations and information about hotel lodging. Many of us, you know, that were there last year, and I don't know, I think, you know, we received some feedback that it was a little bit challenging for some to find hotel rooms, and you know, there weren't enough rooms in the block. And, you know, I think many, many more people came and wanted to physically be there. And not just on site at the HICC, the Novotel is there, but we've also made relationships and opened up pathways to other area hotels. So when you register early, you'll receive all of that information and you can get all of those accommodations squared away. I think that's a really important reason why you want to get this done early, especially if you're planning on attending in person, which we saw the overwhelming majority in 2022 did it attend in person. So I'm just mentioning that here as well as you plan 188 days from now, the conference begins. All right, so I'm going to stop my screen share and let's open it up for some questions. And Syed, I saw that you had a question. So if we can, we're happy to, and we can actually take this, Anuradha, I'm happy if we can unpin and just take this out to a gallery view. That's perfectly fine. Veer, that works for you. That way we can see faces. If you want to switch on your cameras, we'd love to see your faces and you can go ahead and ask questions. Syed, please go ahead.
Yes, Jim. Hi. I'm hope you're doing good.
Yeah, wonderful. It's just great to have you here.
Yeah. Jim, one clarification regarding the scholarship. I see, of course, it's a first-time attendee. Now, a counselor or a career coach who's not part of a university, but is just a part of higher education institute. It's a private institute that's, you know, taking care of an higher education. So, and it's a first-time attendee. Can they also apply for scholarship or is it only for school counselors?
That's a great question, Syed. The scholarship is specifically for school delegates. University delegates, those that are in higher education, are not eligible to apply for the scholarship. Yeah, the scholarship is created specifically to create access for schools. That said, we would, you know, we would still encourage your colleagues to look at the conference and to register and join. But yes, that access is really there to be created for schools through the scholarship program. It's a good question.
Thank you.
Thanks so much, Syed. Okay, let's see. I see some other hands. Togar Pali, please go ahead. I can see your hand there. You're welcome to.
Yeah, hi. Good evening. This is Priyadarshini here, Togar Pali Priyadarshini. Actually, I applied for a scholarship. Like, do we get any acknowledgement about that? Or I don't know. But I applied, it has been 1 week.
Wonderful. Yeah, I'm so happy to hear that you've applied this early. Anuradha, please make a note. And if you can just confirm that the application had been received and what the timeline will be. I know the committee really, as the applications have just started coming in and the conference registration and applications just opened up. Very, very wise on your part to apply this early. Anuradha and the committee will get in touch in terms of the timeline that you can anticipate.
Like, did you receive my application about this?
I do have your application, Priyadarshini. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much. And any specific questions, we were happy to answer them as well. And Arata, if you can just share the info account as well. And if you want to share your personal one for scholars, that's great as well.
Like, when do I get the confirmation that I have, I'm eligible for this scholarship?
Yeah, typically what will happen around the scholarship applications is there will be, once the first batch of applications is received, the committee will begin its reviews. Okay, the committee will begin its reviews. So what we can do is Anuradha and the committee will share a specific timeline as to when you can expect more information about a decision. But your application is in. Okay. And the committee would be in touch in terms of whether you qualify for the scholarship and really what then a scholarship would include. In some cases, it's the registration cost and the cost of the workshops. In some cases, it may also include some travel expenses and accommodation based on the need and the resources.
Sure.
That's not guaranteed, but that would certainly be something that the committee would look at.
Okay. And I'm a 9th cohort member as well.
Wonderful. I love it. So happy to have you here.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you so much for the question. I'm sure just posing that question here, I'm sure many had the same question as well. So I think that's one of the, even just sharing your questions here are also really important. So please go ahead. Others that have a question, I don't see any more hands right now, but you can just unmute, or we're also looking at in the chat. Okay. So Charles, we're acknowledging your, and I can see that, that's being acknowledged there as well. We'll make sure. And Anuradha, I think now is a good time for us just to look at this and make sure that, we have that, at least the acknowledgement that all of the applications are being received and what the anticipated timeline is for review. That'd be really helpful. And yes, please, Charles and Togarpali, please be sure. And you can share with your colleagues around for them to apply for the scholarship as well. I'm happy to see that scholarships are already coming in. Scholarship applications are already coming in. Yeah, Veer, I don't know if you have anything to add to that, but I think—
No, Jim, I'm just adding in the chat. I'm more than happy to also just be available to everyone here. And so if anyone has any questions or any concerns, more than happy also to have—
Okay, perfect.
Communication shared.
May I? Good evening, Jim.
Yes, Dr. Lalita, please go ahead. So lovely to see you.
Now, when is the last date for submitting session proposals? Because I was a little late for the session. And what would be the topic, like any topic related to counseling? Or last time I submitted multiple intelligence, but unfortunately it didn't get,
Thank you, Dr. Lalita. Yes, the 15th of April is the deadline to submit. We would encourage you to submit again. I know last year there was a record number of submissions. There were many, many amazing sessions that the committee, I don't envy the content and research committee. I know Veer was, a big part of that last year as well, and of course will be. But Veer, you can please add any other notes for Dr. Lalita's there as well.
I would only say, Dr. Lalita, I submitted many proposals and many of mine weren't successful as well. So I think I'm certainly motivated to submit
even
more this year.
I wish to do it until it is selected.
yes, that's
so Dr. Lalita, there's a link also there where the overall theme and sub themes you can find right on the website. And Veer, along with Joshua and Vandana from the Content and Research Committee, will be leading an hour long webinar specifically about session proposals. That's on March 1st. So it'd be great for you, once you see that, you receive that invitation, just to register. You can put it on your calendar now. We can even share the time if people want to put it on their calendar now, Anuradha. That'd be really nice. And you can do that. If I can just mention, just as an aside to this, because Dr. Lalita, what you had mentioned, and I, like Veer, I think, that's also, I've had proposals that have come in, and, just by the sheer volume, not all of them can be accepted. But there are also other ways that in the event, let's say, a session proposal comes in, and, last year, I know we had about 112, 113 session proposals for, maybe 35 slots. you'll probably see something like, you know, that go up, you know, this year in terms of the number of proposals, but the session allotments will more or less remain the same in terms of the number that can be accepted. You can also submit content and share resources through the IC3 Institute Resource Library, right? And these are one or two page resources or PPTs that you have, and maybe even some session content that you were planning to present. You know, you could do a one pager and share that with counselors. That's completely an open access resource that's available to school-based delegates at every school in the world. So there are other ways that you can also contribute content. And I just want to mention that here is an important way that you can also contribute, and not just presenting at a conference, but sharing resources in another way. So thank you for that question.
Thank you, Jim. Thank you for that.
All right, let's see. I can see, thanks for being on camera. It's good to see you, Clay and Ava. It's good to see namaste. You. Oh, yes. Please go ahead. You have a question, Ms. Ava.
Yeah, I want to know that what kind of topic that we can submit? Topic, is there any specific topic?
There are, and Veer, perhaps, I think this is a good time. We still have about 8 minutes left. Veer, do you want to take 1 or 2 minutes and just summarize the theme and sub-themes? Perhaps, I know you've been working on them pretty closely.
Yeah, so I think, you know, like I'd mentioned earlier as well, finding purpose through counseling is the theme of the conference. And we've got 6 sub-themes, you know, and I'll just go through them quickly, but ethics and counseling, creating context, counseling as a shared responsibility, access, leadership and counseling, and foundation and trends. And so I think when we think about the session proposal, it's important to keep these subtopics in mind, these sub-themes in mind rather, and then you can structure your session accordingly. So what we have done really is created a document which has also given us some prompts and some potential topics that you may want to consider. And that's available on the website if you look through that part of the website for call for proposals. And so you can actually see and explore these themes in detail. And so there are some topics that we've given there as broad examples, but you're not restricted to use those topics. You can come up with your own topics. You can talk about different aspects and really elaborate on those sub themes. But it's important from the standpoint of making sure that we're being true to the theme of the conference this year, that we really talk about purpose and we talk about the sub themes in detail. But no, you're not restricted to any of these particular titles as such, but it should be connected to the sub themes or the theme in particular, I would say.
No, thank you. Thank you for the
help. And Ms. Aba, there is a link just right in the chat as well. You'll see theme, a theme for the conference and expo is right there. And then of course that those documents are, you know, really helpful for you. And anyone can just go right to the conference website itself. You know, this is a link to a PDF document, but this is also linked from the conference webpage where all of the information from registration, deadlines to the scholarship program, all of it is right there. And again, the website was just completely redesigned. So all of it is there for you. That new website coincided with the opening and the launch of the conference itself. So
yeah, and Jim, just in a sort of a few seconds, really. But since this was asked, and Dr. Lalitha and Abhaman both have asked about this, but really spend time to flesh out the proposal. You know, when we talk about a good proposal, it really has a lot of detail. You know, who do you want to speak with? Co-presenters, you know, you really want to have a think about how you want to frame that proposal and take out time to do it. Because at the end of the day, when the committee is reading these proposals, they really go into a lot of depth into what's the session going to look like, what's the content, what are the learning outcomes coming out of this session, and so on and so forth. So while, of course, 1st of March, we'll really spend time and elaborate on this, but since both of you had this question, I think really important that we don't take it as, you know, just spend a few hours and submit something. It's really important that spend time and really think about what we want to say through the particular proposal that we're putting through.
Thank you, Veer, for that input.
Thank you for all the inputs. Okay, we'll think over it.
Wonderful, Masaba. Thank you so much. And the committee, the Content and Research Committee, is also not just looking at which are the highest quality sessions, but also remember they need to balance the content for schools. They need to have content for institutions. They need to have varying levels, introductory, intermediate, advanced levels. So, you know, I think when a session proposal is considered, it's not just how dynamic is this session itself, but what's the context within the overall, you know, session content that's really there. All right. So we just have a few more minutes left. I want to be sure that we're answering any other questions that are there. And if I can, I'm just looking, I'm scanning in the chat here as well. I'm happy to take any questions. You know, I see, and I did have a question that I wanted to address here. And there was a question regarding past what were considered pre-conference fair and symposium events for universities in past years. And although formally IC3 this year would not be organizing pre-conference fair and symposium events, the host schools in Hyderabad will be organizing school visits for registered universities. More information would be coming out about that. That's just an acknowledgement that many of the university representatives that are traveling to the conference, they also want to take that time to interact with many of the students and the parents and the schools that are in those regions the days leading up and the days after. So more information will be coming out about that. These visits, obviously, you know, they would be completely open at no cost to universities that are registered for the conference and organized by the host schools themselves. IC3 would not be organizing these, but I know the host schools would. So more to come on that. And if there are any questions, we're happy to answer those if our university colleagues have those. All right. And looking at, okay, so what other questions? And let's see. And if I don't see any other questions, perhaps this is a good time for us to share our final notes and words. We're very grateful that you had a chance to join us today. 2023, this annual IC3 conference and expo, you know, I just can't imagine what kind of magic we're going to create together, especially after what we experienced in Hyderabad last year. The scale of the conference is going to double. The venue has doubled. There are some really innovative and I think smart changes based on feedback that we've received. And just to create this, you know, I think if we can bring the world together around finding purpose through counseling, and of course, counseling is giving our students purpose, but I can't tell you how many conversations I've had even just in this last week where we as teachers, as counselors, as principals, as educators across the board, where we've also found our purpose in this work. So you know, it's an honor for me to be here on this journey with you. Veer, it's great to be here with you as well. I'll turn it over to you for a final word and then we can close.
Thanks, Jim. I just want to echo everything that you know you've said and thank everyone for being here and really looking forward to a bigger and conference and really having a big impact in the counseling journey and bringing counseling to every school. So thank you for bringing me along and it's been a pleasure to be here today.
Thanks, Veer. Thanks, everyone. We'll all register early. We'll see you in Hyderabad. In person, virtually, wherever you are. Thank you so much for being here. Bye.
As I work in residential school, it's my dinner time. I'm going to attend my dinner.
Enjoy. This is perfect. Enjoy that. And then you come and join us for dinner in Hyderabad.
Okay, I'm going to mess. Okay, bye. Good night.
All the best. Bye-bye.